smile pretty.
All right. We're welcome here this morning to the Montana Baptist Church. Let's look at our announcements. Today, the offering plates are still in the same location as they have been since we regathered together. And you can put your tithes and offerings in them. Coming up this week will be the congregation meeting on the at 6:30 on Tuesday. Also, collecting non-perishable items for the YMCA and the food that they give out in such as individual fruit and pudding cups and things of that nature are being collected and then donated to the Y to those who are in need. June and July, Jamie has some baby bottles.
At home.
At home. But that would be for expectations.
I have to.
Put your spare change and things of that nature in there. And also, let's not forget the love gift offerings. And then coming up in September the 13th, that Sunday, the 150th anniversary of the Montana Baptist Church. Operation Christmas Child continues, and also there's listed in the bulletin are those names of individuals who are having birthdays at Country Comfort. Any other announcements?
Yes, we had a Norwich party for our missions group yesterday, and it was pretty successful. We have a total of over $500 right now, and we'll be getting 20% in that for our missions fund. But I do have Norwich's books if anybody's familiar with it and would like to hear about it or like to order. I can offer them. And also for those that have online and are friends with me or on the Montana Baptist Church thing, there should be a link there that they can go online and order also.
Any other announcements? Mission outreach. Mission moments.
I have a little story to read this morning. Along with our daily Bible readings from the church, I also read from daily devotions from Guidepost. And on June the 1st, I thought this would fit for our mission love gift box. It's called a Wanderer. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And that came from Luke 15:4. And this is a little story that goes along with it. Winston, our terrier, loves to accompany my wife and me on hikes through the Colorado Mountains. Living life full on, his ears flopping in the wind, he leads the way. On a crisp morning, we took an unfamiliar trail, passing rock walls on the right and sheer drops on the left. With no woods to explore, Winston ran ahead out of sight. 20 minutes passed without his return. We got panicky and we whistled. Winston, my wife called, with tears streaking her face. Oh, he's fallen, or do you suppose a bobcat got him? We heard a faint whimper overhead. Stay here in case he returns. Walking around the base of the cliff, looking for a way up, I wondered, is this how God feels when I wander? Do I cause him the same heartache? I struggled up the wall as the sandstone scraped my arms like glass. How often had God sacrificed all to chase after me? I'd always felt I had a short leash, but still I wondered. This lesson offered more than learning to watch my pet closer. God taught me his undying devotion to bring me back to his side. Eventually I reached the top. Soaked with sweat, my wife called, I have Winston! I looked over the edge, both relieved and annoyed. Not a scratch on him, she said, and Winston's tail wagged as I cuddled. I sat a moment. Who knew I could care about a dog so much? It struck me again, the parallel between my love for Winston and God's love. It warmed me, and I thought, that really suits our love gift box, because as we drop our coins in the love gift box each day or when we shop, whenever we have coins or maybe a bill to put in, we have to always remember and thank God that He loves us so much. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you. Any other mission related? If not, I have one. There's a mission field that is beyond these four walls, and it's called our country. And today being Flag Day, I think it's appropriate that we would sing the Star Spangled Banner. In your hymnals, because this is sort of ad-libbed, if you will, is 607. But if you've ever heard the history of the Star Spangled Banner written by Francis Scott Key in the harbor outside of the city of Baltimore, where Fort McHenry is at. You see, during this very tumultuous time of struggle and freedom from the British, Fort McHenry was a stort, a stronghold for U.S. forces. And there, flying over Fort McHenry, was the Stars and Stripes. And during that battle, which was not only a naval battle, but it was also some U.S. ships were damaged in trying to repel the British Armada. And on the ship that Francis Scott Key was on was also some U.S. sailors in the undercarriage of the ship. Their cry was, as it went through the night, "Does the flag still stand? Is it still there? Is it still waving?" Because in their hearts they knew as long as that flag was waving, there was hope. And from the decks of that, Francis Scott Key wrote our national anthem. But the history that bears out that which took place on land at Fort McHenry, the individuals that held that flag up. So you see, the command from the British commander was that all ships in that armada were to focus their full fire on that flag. Hmm. And as the night dragged on, the sailors below would say, "Is it still flying? Does it still wave?" And on land, as one of the shells would hit that flagstaff, someone would go out and put it back up and hold it up, and maybe giving their life to hold that flagstaff up. You read it, it's history, it's there. The foot of that flagpole was littered with men that gave their lives hold up that flag. Stand, if you are able, as we sing our Star Spangled Banner.
Strike, stand right strong.
Okay. Our responsive reading this morning is found in 355. The love of the Lord never ceases. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness.
The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him.
The Lord is good to those who wait on him, to the soul that seeks him. It is good that one should walk quietly for the salvation of the Lord. It is good for a man that he bear the yoke of his, in his youth.
Let him sit alone in silence when he has laid it on him. Let him put his mouth in dust. There may yet be an opening. Let him give his cheek to the smiter and be filled with his soul.
For the Lord
will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not willingly afflict or grieve the sons of men. Great is thy faithfulness.
And if you're in the Bible, turn right over to 354. His eyes on the sparrow. Thank you. listen to you, and may we be able to recognize even the smallest minute blessings that you give each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you so much. Be with us now as we go into the message portion. May your words ring clear and true to those who are here and to those who are listening beyond these four walls. And Lord, may you get the glory for all things that are said and done. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning. Today I'm reading out of Romans chapter 8, verses 14 through 18. For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am of flesh, sold into bondage to sin. For that which I am doing, I do not understand, for I am not practicing what I would like to do. But I am doing the very thing I hate. But if I do the very thing I do not wish to do, I agree with the law, confessing that it is good. So now, no longer am I the one doing it, but sin which indwells me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me, that is, in my flesh, for the wishing is present in me, but the doing of the good is not. May God add his blessing to these readings. This is kind of read up here, and that's what I was reading. And you want me to read it? I don't know.
Oh, okay, if you want to.
Yeah, I apologize. It said chapter 8 at the top of my Bible page, and that's what I was reading.
It all happens. It happens to us.
Okay, let's try this again. For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you have not received a spirit of slavery, leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed to us. Sorry about that.
It happens.
Thank you for reading that scripture, and even the first one, because I know that when we read God's word, somebody's getting blessed.
That's right.
So somebody needed to hear that, Mary Sue. I don't know who it might be, but someone needed to hear that which was read. We're looking at Romans chapter 8. And the title of this message is, You're Adopted. Have you ever been in a family situation, whether it be brother, sister, or sometime, where they said something that was just totally opposite of what they should be doing, and you as maybe an older brother or an older sister or said to the, you know you're adopted, aren't you?
Guilty.
What's that?
Guilty.
Guilty, okay. Now the term adoption here, you know, is a wonderful term. You know, even in real life, in real time, where families adopt a child, they bring that child, they nurture that child, regardless of the age. They bring it into their lives, and that individual becomes a part of their family. And sometimes, sadly, we see the opposite, where an individual will be adopted into a family, and then they become ostracized because by the other members of the family, because, oh, you're not really one of us. And I know the dynamics that, you know, as later on, an individual who might be adopted might want to know their medical histories and things of that nature. And I understand that. But at it doesn't dismiss the fact that, you know, you're part of a family. And some of us have been fortunate enough in our lives that we've had multiple parents where we've gone to, you know, there's somebody's house so often that we begin to call them mom, or they might pop. I have a family that, you know, their son and I are just a day apart. I spent more time with them than sometimes I did in my own house. And I just began to call them mom and pop. You know, that's just what we did. And I hopefully there's someone in your life that you were able to share and care about in that aspect. But what we're talking about here is being adopted into the family of God. You see, with God there is no strangers. You know, there is no, how shall I say, inequality. God loves us all. And here in the book of Romans, Romans is the, I guess from my aspect, if I don't refer to Romans or look in Romans for something, you know, it's an odd week, because Romans follows the book of Acts. Acts is the Acts of the Apostles, that which the Holy Spirit inspired upon those individuals to go out and to do things. And by the way, he still does that. And still encouraging us to go out and to do things for the Lord. But the book of Romans is the how-to. Paul lays it out. This is the mechanics of what it's like, what's expected of us. You know, if you've ever read a how-to manual, you need to follow the instructions. Don't go from instruction number one down to number 10. Oh, I can do that in between. There's something in between you might have missed. And see, Paul was addressing that. He was addressing that as it regards being adopted into the family of God. You see, way back when Abraham, when God impressed upon Abraham to leave the Earl of Chaldees and follow the Lord's leading, you know, whatever, however God impressed upon him, Abraham believed. And God promised Abraham that your seed would be that, like the thousands, like the sands of the sea. There would be that many people. You and I here this morning, we are recipients of the obedience that Abraham followed. Because those promises that God promised Abraham, he promises us. For here we see Paul addressing this particular scenario, if you will, or situation, or life lesson, as to being adopted into the family of God. And there's only one way to do that. Paul not only addresses it here, but also over in Galatians when he speaks to the folks there. The two are so parallel with one another. But here Paul is ministering to the folks at Rome, and also he was ministering to the folks there in Galatia. The same scenario. Paul here reads, "For as many of you are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of God." You know, that word right there, led by, you know, led by the Spirit. Of course, that Spirit is the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. He is the agency, if you will. Anything that happens in your life or in our lives as a church or as the body of Christ, it's done by the agency and the office of the Holy Spirit. Here we see, being as many are led by. You see, God leads us. He doesn't drive us. I want you to get that. He leads us. He leads his sheep. You and I, as believers, we're called sheep. And he is the great shepherd. Jesus himself said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." They follow Jesus. Jesus is not back here. And too many times in organizations, especially within the church, we get ahead of God. Have you ever heard that statement? They've gotten ahead of God. Where, okay, we'll do this, but somewhere along the line they forgot to include God in their endeavor. But yet, way back in the psalmist, David said in the 23rd Psalm, he leads me beside still waters. He leads me in the paths of his righteousness for his namesake. Paul here is saying to the church of Rome and saying to us even today, you see, this was written probably in about 60 AD. It was just some 30-some years past the death of Christ. He said, you can't follow two natures. You're either led by the Spirit or you're led by the effects of the world. And we need to hear the voice of God. We need not to be driven. Several years ago, there was a couple of almost heretical books that were written. Something about a purpose-driven something. And you don't drive anything with God. You follow. I'm glad somebody said amen. You follow. You know, we don't get ahead of God. I said, we can't follow two natures. In other words, you can't follow rules, regulations, and requirements and expect that to give you glorification or your salvation, if you will. I'm sorry. That's called works. It don't work that way. Whereas we follow. We follow the Holy Spirit, that which is inside of us. That's God inside of us, leading us down a particular way to go. Things begin to change in our lives. We begin to align ourselves with the Spirit of God. Our spirit, the spirit that's in us. You know, we're a three-part being. We're body, soul, and spirit. You know, it's like having a tire. You can't have a tire without a rim, and you can't have a tire without that big rubber thing on the outside, and you can't have a tire unless it has air in it. So we've got a three-part being there. So you and I are three parts, body, soul, and spirit. We have the physical frame. We have the spirit, that which knows, and we have the soul, that which is conscious of ourselves. So, the Holy Spirit is here telling the Apostle Paul that we need to be led by the Spirit. We can't follow two natures. You know, in a lot of churches, you see, you know, folks running around with masks on, and this was before the coronavirus. You know, they cry out Sunday morning, you know, God is our Father. Then on Monday morning, they live like orphans. You know, I think it's time that we take the mask off within the churches, and let's follow Jesus. For we have not received the spirit of bondage. Here Paul then is addressing the fact that, okay, if we are going to follow those other rules, regulations, manner of dress, color of hair, rings, jewelry, and all that that goes with it, we're putting ourselves back into bondage. And bondage generates fear. And, oh, did I really do enough? Or, oh, my hair's not long enough. Is it too long? You know, all those things create fear in our lives if we follow that particular method of trying to attain our salvation through works. But you have received the spirit of adoption. You and I, as believers in Jesus Christ, we are adopted into the grandest family that you could. We're part of the, I think there's a song that says, are part of the family of God. Mm-hmm. We call brothers and sisters around here. You know, I look out here and I see brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. I once heard an individual say that I just can't do that because they were thinking too little. Mm-hmm. They were thinking of their own nucleus family as being just their brothers and sisters. But look out here and I see brothers and sisters.
Amen.
And we should address them as that. Because we have one Father.
Praise God.
Praise God. A heavenly father was once riding in a car with a young man that, and a friend of mine who's a brother. And of course, this individual always wanted to know your genealogy and all this kind of stuff. And he said to my friend over here, he said, "Well, you know, how do you fit into the family?" I said, "Well, that's my brother." And he sat back here trying to figure out, "No, wait a minute, you know." Then we pulled him over and said, "Well, you know, my brother's the Lord." Oh, I knew that. But he was trying to piece it together in the physical realm. You see, we're adopted into the family. You know, we're in the arms of, in the family of God. You know, and that's quite a family to be in. And just imagine that if every one of us who look differently all carry the same characteristics of our Heavenly Father, what a difference this world would be.
Amen.
You see, that's the problem. You know, we see folks out in the world that are, they proclaim to be a member of the family, but they live like orphans or illegitimate children. You know, the stuff that's going on, we see that, I don't need to tell you, you guys watch the news as much as I do. Well, only I might watch a different station. One that tells you the truth. But anyway, regarding that, we see stuff unfolding. And that's just a matter of absence of God. God is not influencing these individuals' lives. And even some of them are reverend, pastors, leaders of churches and denominations that are fostering hate, civil unrest, perpetrating that which God denies. You see, they're not part of the family of God. You see, each and every one of us, like I said earlier, we may all look different, but we should all have the same characteristics. Now, granted, there is individuals who are, and myself included, I'm not there yet. There's work to be done. But if you have received the spirit of adoption, you're in line for an inheritance that's out of this world. Literally. Paul here writes, "For you have received the Spirit." It's God the Holy Spirit that's leading you. He is the Spirit of God is the adoption agency. He's the one that adopts us into the family. Whereby we cry, "Abba, Father." You see, that word Abba is an English translation. Actually, it's Aramaic. The English translators had such reverence for that word that they wouldn't translate it into the King's English, because of the putting too much of a familiarity on the word. Abba means daddy. They reverenced God's word that much that they would not write daddy, making it too familiar. Now, all of us here, in one form or fashion, we've had a father, an earthly father. Be called a daddy is something else to be called dad. Which, by the way, I thought today was Father's Day.
I did too.
That's next week, if you haven't looked at your calendar. So I'll have to come up with something different for next week. But to call the English translators there, the King James folks, they had so much reverence for the name that they would not write daddy. Because they thought that it would breed and fester a too familiarity and lessen the importance of God. Maybe you've heard some of those statements that have been used, you know, the man upstairs. You know, I'm hanging out with Jesus. You know, how about, you've heard that. Not giving God the reverence and respect that's due him. And taking God in a nonchalant manner. That's a dangerous position to be in. But here we see the Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit. There in verse 16. The Holy Spirit itself in us bears witness with our spirit. Remember we said we are a three-part being, body, soul, and spirit. Some folks in this world put body, soul, and spirit and mind, making you a four-part being. Well, to those individuals in that world, which is biblically incorrect, the mind, the last time I looked, is part of the body. So, we see here that our spirit begins to reflect the Spirit of God that resides within us. We should be reflectors. We should be mirrors. We should be ambassadors of God wherever we go. Not perfect. Not perfect. I'm not preaching perfect salvation. Salvation is perfect, but we're not. But there should be tangible evidence that we're under the influence of the Spirit. I've never seen that in the paper yet. DUI, driving under the spirit, under the influence of the Lord. I wonder how they would try that. Believe me, in the current state that we're in and in a need for money, they would probably figure out a way. But here we are. If our spirit reflects that which we are under the influence of, Scripture tells us that we're ever changing from glory to glory. We're going forward. We're not going back. We're going forward in the power and the Spirit of the Lord, knowing that we are a member of the greatest family that has ever immense, a family of God, who God loves each and every one of us.
That's right.
And if we are, if the children of God, if you're a child of God, you have an heir. Oh, have any of you ever been the recipient of an estate or somebody donates something to you, a part of a will? You know, have you ever had any of that? Yeah. Sometimes it's a blessing, sometimes it's a curse. But here, we are heirs of God. The promises that God has given from Abraham on back are our promises. The promises of eternal life, the promise of heaven, the promise of no more sin, sickness, or tears. Wow. And we're joint heirs with Jesus. We got something to be happy about.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have to, you know, it doesn't get any higher than that, if you will, on the scale of things in this world. You see, God owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, and all the oil, and all the gold, and all the silver, and everything in it. You know, we're in line for that type of creation. Not that it's going to mean anything in the presence of God. Money can't buy. Jesus Christ, yeah. And he paid for it. We can't buy it. It's already been paid for. An inheritance that's, like I said, that's out of this world. Isn't that something to be happy about?
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you're awake out there. It's good to hear your voices. Because for so long, it just echoed in here when Jamie and I were doing this one-on-one, you know, it was strange. It's good to see you this morning. We're joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Everything that belongs to Jesus belongs to us. and it belongs to us because of his death on Calvary's cross. He made it possible for us to be a part of the family of God. We can be a part of the family of God only through Jesus Christ. It's the only way. So, that we may also suffer with him. Well, what does that mean, preacher? You mean I'm going to have to suffer a few things here on earth? You know, I'm going to have to, you know, go through what Jesus, I'm going to have to be nailed to a cross? No, that's not what it means. It means we may have to suffer some trials and tribulations. We may have to go through a few things. We may have to endure a storm or two. You know, the book of Hebrews tells us that for whom God, whom the Lord loved, he chastens and scourges the son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. For what son is there whom the father does not chasten? Let me ask you, children, has your father ever chastened you? Your physical, your earthly parent. You ever been corrected by your earthly father? I see a lot of heads nodding. Maybe they don't want to remember. I don't need to know what you did. You know, God does the same thing. Did you learn anything when your earthly father corrected you?
I think so.
Don't do it again.
God does the same thing. He wants us to learn something. He wants us to be strengthened. He wants us to learn because he loves us. How many of us maybe have used this line? This is going to hurt me more than it's going to hurt you.
Never worked out that way.
But yet from a parent's side, that ministering a punishment because you love someone. I think God does the same thing. It hurts him more than it hurts us. But he knows it's for our own good, right?
Right.
For if we were suffering with him, we don't need to suffer that which he suffered on the cross. He did it for us. But you know, there's some folks in this world that think that they have to beat themselves up, be self-abused, even to the point where there's a group of individuals that think they have a whip about this long, and they constantly put it over their shoulder till their back bleeds, thinking that they're suffering with Christ. They're suffering for Christ. Or doing something self-destructive, hoping that will attain them some sort of holiness. And it's not there. Comes by faith. But all the sufferings that Christ endured, and all the teachings and the things that we endure through that educational process called life. Life getting older. Life seeing things through different eyes. Life when we look around and we see destruction, death, and we know that there is an answer to that. It's called Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And it is our calling and our station in life that we tell these individuals that it's Jesus Christ is the answer. Not protesting, not burning and killing. Jesus Christ is the answer. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time, here, Paul is reassuring. You know, sometimes we have to endure storms. Sometimes we have to go through the things that we really don't want to do. But the reckon, Paul is saying, I realize that the sufferings of this present time, and this was 60 A.D., and you imagine what was unfolding in Paul's life? He was about due to lose his because he proclaimed Christ as Savior. There is no other God but Jesus Christ. But in Rome, it was you were to declare your allegiance to Caesar, who thought he was a god. There is no other God but Caesar, and then you could live. But those steadfast believers, there's no other God but Jesus Christ. And it cost them something. The suffering of this world is not to be considered worthy to be compared with that which waits for us in glory. We can endure this. We may have to, we don't like it, but we have to endure it. But that which awaits for us in glory, when it shall be revealed in us, Paul is saying, we should be mirrors reflecting daily the love of Jesus Christ. His glory shall be, the word is shall be, not maybe, might be, oh, it could be, if I feel like it. No, it's that it shall be. I look out across these folks here this morning, like your smiling faces, and I see Jesus reflecting off of you. Take that to that world out there that needs it. They need it just as much as we needed it. We know the truth. Now it's time we share the truth. Because who knows when God's going to wrap this up. And like I said last week, it's a great joy to know that you're going to go to heaven. But it's an even greater joy to know that you're taking somebody with you. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Join us as we stand for our closing hymn, number 553. Just a closer walk with thee. And how's it feel to be a doctor? I'm so part of the family of God. That's stuck in my head. Maybe we should have started with that. But we'll do 553 because that's what we said we would do. assured to walk safely towards you. And Lord, we just thank you for your love. We thank you for that we can claim you as our Heavenly Father and be a part of the family of God. What a wonderful family it is. And Lord, we thank you for your Son, Jesus, who made it all possible. And Lord, we just ask that you would dismiss us now with a peace that surpasses all understanding. And Lord, may we look to you in all situations and circumstances in our lives this week and forevermore. In Jesus' name.
Nobody's there.
Yeah, she's still working it though.
I think I'm good. He's going to serve
me.
I don't want that money.
Oh, okay. I don't either.
Okay.
Stay safe.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.